Virtualization is dead. That might be a little bit an exaggeration, but yeah, let's see at the end how much truth there is in this sentence. So let me take you back to the time where the internet was still black and white. So actually not to 99, but to 2006, when our company was still a little startup, and yeah, we did what most startups are doing, we built an application. And it was a small PHP application back then. I mean, we didn't have much traffic, and yeah, scaling wasn't important. It was just a small PHP application. And luckily, we had some success, so we got some traffic. And then you come to the point where you need to scale. And what are you doing with PHP on scaling? Yeah, you just put some more machines to them. And in this setup with four machines, it's still fine, because you don't have to take care about the deployment process. I mean, we did it back then with an SVN up on each machine, so it was, life was kind of easy. But then you get more traffic and you have to scale again someone. And someone, you will reach this. And then you're thinking about, okay, now deployment isn't that cool anymore by doing SSH into the machines and doing an SVN up. You're thinking about, okay, maybe we should now start to use something like Chef or Puppet for taking care of the machines. And we decided to use Chef for whatever reason, I'm not sure. And we decided to use Capistrano for deployments. So life was better now, somehow. And then we came to the point where we had about 100 million unique users a month. So we are thinking again about, okay, what now? I mean, PHP isn't that scalable unless you're Facebook. And yeah, what can we do now? And an idea that came up is, let's do it in a service-oriented way. So we thought about, why shouldn't we split up this big PHP application which we deployed the whole application on each machine, and we couldn't scale it in a more fine granulated way. Why don't we split it up? And so we did it. And this is now a small example of how it might look for us. It's quite simplified, and we are a question and answer platform. So, yeah, of course, we have a question service and an answer service and a user service. So these are the in a domain model, the entities we are using, and we still have PHP in the front. So because we didn't want to do a big bang migration, so we just slowly carving out the stuff of our PHP application, and when we are finished in about 1 year maybe, we can even throw away the old PHP front end and can do something like play on Scala as a front end for our services. And with this kind of architecture, we now can take a single service and set up an instance of the service. So yeah, now we have one service, but one service isn't, or one instance of the service isn't enough, because it's not HA. So you might want to have two services or two instances. And if you're doing something like an canary deployment, where you are having test instances with live traffic, you might want to have even a third instance. But you can scale it as much as you like. And the question now is, okay, where should we run the services? I mean, the obvious idea is, okay, let's go cloud. And who of you is using EC2 instances? Okay, so who is using something like a private cloud on VMware? Okay, so yeah, we chose VMware because the German data privacy laws, it's always better to have the sensible data on our premise. So we built something like a private cloud. And we came up with this kind of solution. So we somehow integrated Chef into VMware so that with a single with a knife, with the command line tune of Chef, we could start easily a new instance on our VMware cluster and assigned roles on this new machine. So with this single command, everything was what happened in the background was, okay, well, now we set a Pixie pre-boot environment. And then the command line tool creates the VM, and the VM boots, gets the data from the Pixie server, installs the operating system, and then Chef kicks in and starts the application, or installs the application, and everything is fine, because then our service, which is based on Finagle, announces itself on Zookeeper, and everything is done. So with this kind of setup, it was like if someone from the development team came and said, yeah, we need a new service, it was like a one command line, that set up the whole infrastructure. So we put some more stuff into it, like create a Jenkins environment, do a Confluence entry with all the information about this kind of service, start three instances, and do everything you need. So a new service was like, it took 5 minutes for us to set everything up. And okay, this was kind of okay now, so we could lean back and enjoy life, but you have some downsides with this kind of VMs, and here are three of them. And the first thing is the hypervisor, and it doesn't add so much overhead to your VMs, but it's noticeable. So like depending on which articles you read, it's like 3 to 5% of overhead, and yeah, of course it's latency you didn't want or don't want. And another point is administration. So normally you want to keep it simple, and we are aiming to have someone like about 100 in services if you multiply it by 3, because that's the lowest number of instances we have per service. We will end up someone with about 300 VMs, and we have to manage it somehow. It's quite fine with Chef, but still you have 300 machines where you should do monitoring, and yeah, that's not so great. And another point is cost, because either you're paying EC2 for the instances, or you have to pay VMware the license costs, which are, yeah, both isn't that great. So what comes to the rescue? Mesos, yes. And have a short time to read it. Now you know what they say, what Mesos is. But yeah, basically it's just a system where a slave says, yeah, here I have 10 CPUs and this amount of RAM, and then you have frameworks which can request those resources. So a service, this is requests from Mesos some resources I need, one CPU, where can I run? And then Mesos master tells it, yeah, here, run on this machine. So that's the theory, but I will tell you why I love it. Why it has really, enlightened our days at work. And before I come to that, I will tell you a little bit about the history of Mesos. So it's inspired by Google Borg, which Google is using for their clusters. And then this idea was developed at UC Berkeley in the Red Labs, where also Spark comes from. And some companies then adopted it and developed it further. So you might know this company. They are using it for some kind of request response type of applications, like services like we are using it. And you might also know this company. They are using it primarily for batch jobs, like running Hadoop or Spark on a Mesos cluster. And another interesting thing is that Twitter is using it on bare metal machines, and Airbnb is using it on EC2 instances. So it doesn't have to be mutually exclusive. You can even run Mesos on VMs if you want to have the advantage of this cluster management. And there's quite a lot of things that can run on Mesos currently. So this is just a short overview of the current ecosystem. And you might have seen this, but I won't talk about it. Sorry to disappoint you. I will talk about Kronos and Marathon. And let's start with Kronos. So Kronos, if you're taking the basic Linux system, Kronos is a replacement for your normal cron daemon. So you can run periodically tasks. And the nice thing with Kronos is you have tolerance. So you can run it in an HA mode, and the Kronos master can just die and another one takes over. So Kronos also takes care of the distribution of your tasks. So it asks Mesos, where can I run this kind of job? And Mesos says, run on this machine. So you don't have to take care about, like, if you're using the old style cron, this task only runs on this machine and, whatever. Kronos stores all the state data in Zookeeper. So for example, if the master dies and another takes over, the data gets read back from Zookeeper. Another thing, now, so these are the interesting things. The next things are nice to have, I would say. And you have dependencies. So in an ETL job, you can say, this job should run only if the other one is successfully or has successfully finished. You have nice statistics, and they don't give just average runtimes because, we all know averages sucks. They give percentiles. So you can see how long your job is taking or if there's something bad in your cluster, if a job takes longer a little bit. And something you don't have in your normal cron daemon is also the resolution below 1 minute. So you can schedule jobs for like running every second or 10 seconds. And we are using Kronos for our ETL jobs, so we run some cascading or scaling jobs on Kronos. And the other interesting thing in the Mesos ecosystem is Marathon. And Marathon is basically your control panel to get your jobs running. You can put there your application, you provide an URI where your application can be downloaded, and you say, I want to have 10 instances of this application, I want 2 CPUs per instance and 1 gig of RAM. And there's another new kit on the block, which is quite cool. It's Docker. And Mesos can, or Marathon can easily run Docker containers on your Marathon or your Mesos infrastructure. For running applications on this kind of cluster, you will also have, or you will also love the constraints that Marathon provides, or Mesos in general. You can say, this kind of application should only run on separate machines. So because if on one machine there might be enough resources and I have a service with 5 instances, it might happen that these 5 instances are on one machine, which is kind of bad when this machine fails, because it will take a little bit longer for fold or for disaster recovery. And now coming to how we do continuous delivery on this ecosystem. So you might not be surprised if the first step is commit your code and push it to the master. Then Jenkins kicks in and does the usual local tests and builds a fat jar file and loads it up to some kind of storage. And by the way, we are using Jenkins still on VMs and slaves. And if you're interested in running Jenkins on Mesos, talk to the eBay guys, because they have Jenkins running on Mesos. So for every developer has some kind of private Jenkins instance. So just talk to them or do some search on the net. So the next step is start a test instance on Mesos. We are talking to Marathons. Yeah, just start a new instance. The instance is then started in a test mode, so we can do some integration tests. So for example, if we are deploying the user service, we will request the question service with a kind of special header that fetches data exactly from the new version of the user service, so that we can detect some incompatibles in the versions. If there is everything fine, we will start the service in a canary mode. So at this stage, this new version is already running in the production cluster and gets already production traffic. So at this state, we have 2 versions actually running at the same time. So it's quite important to have it backward compatible. And then it's running for a couple of minutes or hours, depends on how much traffic we are having. And we observe the error rate on this canary. And if everything is fine, we will start the deployment on the production on the whole cluster. So I hope I have ignited you now to have a deeper look into Mesos and Marathon. So I recommend to you these 2 pages. So of course, the Apache page, and then the guys at Mesosphere are currently quite active and at developing Mesos and Marathon and all the frameworks. And if you have questions, because there's not so much time, just grab one of the guys in his blue t-shirts and let's have a talk outside. Or you can contact me on Twitter or write me an email. So coming back to the beginning, I don't think virtualization is dead, but for our service infrastructure, Mesos is the right thing to have. And even if we are having VMs for like Jenkins, I'm so happy that Marathon and Mesos exist.